Well, good morning, church. How are we doing today? So I'm Dave Strayer. I'm one of the deacons here, and I'm going to be doing the announcements this morning. There's a lot to go through, but so I have to have my notes up here. So sorry about that. But if you're new here, it's your first time here today, you should have been handed a heartbeat. That's a great way to find out a lot of things that are going on in our church. If you're more digitally centered, you can go to the QR code in the front of your pew there and open up, if you know how to do that, and open up a connection that will provide a lot of information on our church as well. A couple of announcements. Today, after this service, the pastor is going to be holding a baptism class at noon. Lunch will be provided. Our church council meeting that was scheduled for today has been moved to the 28th at 4 p.m. The quarterly business meeting has also been moved. That one. Yeah, I lost my.
On the screen, Dave.
That one, thank you, is on. I'm probably going to get fired after this first time as announcer. Wednesday, January 31st, there's a men's breakfast on February 3rd at 8 a.m. That's Howard's group over there. A Plarn gathering at 10 a.m. in the fellowship hall on the 27th. And I think that's it. Aaron's going to talk to you a little later about some things he's planning with our music. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Aaron.
Can you hear me now? All right. Well, hey, welcome. Good morning, church. We're so glad that you're here with us today. I have a question. Are you joyful to be in this house this morning? Yes. All right. Well, hey, you know what? I'm going to invite you to stand to your feet. And I just want us to take a moment to pray, to just prepare our hearts as we worship the Lord this morning. Would you bow your heads with me? Father God, we are so thankful, Lord, that we have a place that we can worship you, that we can magnify your name. Lord, we come to you this morning with joyful hearts, with grateful hearts. God, we're thankful that we have another day. We're thankful that we can be here together as your church, as your people, to sing to you, to pray to you, Lord, to draw near to you through the proclamation of your word. God, I pray that you would bless this time. Pray that you would just use it for your glory. We thank you. We praise you. Say all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
There's joy in the house of the Lord. be quiet. We shout out your praise.
We were the bakers, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace.
There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. Shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be
God be the glory. Amen. Amen. And his word says, his word says we have amazing grace. Amen. Amazing grace and mercy. The mercy is wide. We just have to choose to follow him. Let's lift up Amazing Grace. It's a little different version, but I think you'll catch on.
So thankful for your amazing grace for us, Lord. God, I just pray that we would just have ears to listen this morning to the things that you would have us hear, Lord, during this service as well as throughout our days, God. We're grateful that we have a place that we can make a joyful noise unto you, Lord, that we can celebrate you. We can celebrate your son, Jesus. And God, we don't know what things you have in store for us, Lord, but we know that they're good. We know that you're in control. and that you're faithful. And Lord, I just pray that during this time of offering, Lord, during this time of drawing near to you, Lord, that we would just be open to the things that you have in store. God, we thank you. We praise you. We love you in Jesus' name.
Amen. He has good plans for us. The song is all about Psalms 23 and lifting up his word.
The Lord is my shepherd, and he is everything I need. I will not worry.
What, we're in the shadow or on the mountain, he has good plans for us.
Surely your goodness and mercy will follow after me. For you will find me, 'cause I'll be dwelling in the house of God. Surely your goodness and mercy will follow after me. Fear will find me, 'cause I'll be dwelling in the house of God. Surely your goodness and mercy will follow after me. Fear will I'll be dwelling in the house of God. Surely your goodness, mercy will follow after me. Fear will not find me, 'cause I'll be dwelling in the house of God. He has good plans. He has good plans for me.
I will take heart in deserts and gardens. He has good plans. He has good plans for me. If I know my Father, I know my Father has good plans. Good plans. Good plans. If I know my good plans. Amen.
Amen. Let's give them a round of applause. Amen. Hey, we just turn to the person next to you and say, I'm so glad that you're in the house of the Lord today. Amen. Amen. Hey, if you would, turn in your Bible. We're gonna start in 1 Corinthians chapter 9. Because even though we're going through 1 Peter, our key verses are going to be that we're really going to focus in on are going to be in 1 Corinthians. But if you also pull out your sermon notes, the heartbeat or your bulletin, you notice that the weekly question is, what is your view of marriage? And I want you to be thinking about that answer. What is your view of marriage? Now, at this point, there are many people in here, because we have a lot of young people as well, that aren't married. And we have people who used to be married or never will be married. And so I want you to know that this message is for everybody in here, whether you're married or not, whether you'll never be married or have not yet been married. This message is for all of us, because in understanding the biblical view of the sacred matrimonial covenant, that is between one husband and one wife, one man and one woman, we also understand the character of Jesus Christ. And I think all of us in here who know Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior would say, we all should want to know the character of Christ, amen? And so we're going to learn a little bit more about the character of Christ by understanding the relationship in a sacred covenant marriage between husband and wife. So we're going to see that. So if you would turn in your Bible, we're going to start there, 1 Corinthians 9. I'm going to read verse 19 and then 22 to 23. And the overarching thing that we're going to do today is you're going to assess your view of marriage, but also get deeper, walk closer with Christ and getting to know his character a little bit better, because he reveals his character in the covenant relationship. So it's for all of us in here. So verse 19, for though I am free from all, I have made myself a servant to all. This is Paul writing, that I might win more of them. So we're getting a little bit of a view into what we're going to be talking about in the marriage relationship. And in this regard, we're seeing that as a follower of Christ, I'm giving up my freedom for a higher purpose than my own wants. And then verses 22 and 23, to the weak I became weak, that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that I by all means might save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, that I may share with them in its blessings. And so we're getting a little bit of a glimpse of the character of Christ, where I submit, I willingly become weak, so that I can win some to the gospel, that some would come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And if you think about it, Jesus Christ went to the cross, and he didn't go screaming and shouting. He didn't go cussing to the cross. He freely went to the cross like a sheep goes to the slaughter, like a lamb to the slaughter. Why would he weakly, as the world would see it, without putting up a fight, why would he go to the cross? Because he had a higher purpose than sparing his own life. That higher purpose was your eternal life. By his shed blood, you have eternal life. So he He came to earth. He became flesh, fully God, fully man, but he freely gave up the position as God the Son in heaven to be God the Son on earth, that he would win you. So you see this strength and meekness. And as we talk about the marriage relationship, we're going to see that is also true in the relationship between husband and wife. Is that if the husband and wife, if they demand to be completely separate in all things, as though it was some part of a contract that you are you and I am me and we are never going to submit to each other, you will know, if you've ever known a marriage like that, it doesn't work. And likewise with Jesus Christ, when he went to the cross, remember Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane? Lord, if it's your will, remove this cup, but not my will, your will be done. There was a submission to his heavenly Father. And so here we see Paul also saying, look, I become all things to all people. I freely become weak so that I may win the weak to Christ. There's a higher purpose. All relationships, the second point I wanted to start with, all relationships, every single relationship in your life has a duty to it. Because that's the other thing. First thing is we don't like to submit. The other thing is we often like to have the relationship without the duty. But there is no relationship in your life that does not have a duty to it. 100% of them do. Can you imagine going to the grocery store, bringing up your cart full of stuff, going to the cashier, and the cashier saying, I'm not ringing you up. They're not going to have that job very long. Their duty, their responsibility is to ring up the customers. Can you imagine a fireman going to a car accident? I'm not getting out of the truck. Or the house fire, I'm not getting out. They wouldn't be a fireman very long. Or a soldier saying, I'm not going to serve our country. I'm not going into a war. So understand, as we get into the relationship, because it can be a perplexing, a daunting, a challenging subject to talk about submitting or yielding. But understand that 100% of the relationships in your life have a duty to them. There's always a duty. And so we're going to get into now 1 Peter. And before I do, I want to have a parallel track here. And the parallel track is a preacher who lived in the 1800s, probably the most prolific preacher in the history, 2,000-year history of the church. His name was Charles Spurgeon. He preached a lot about marriage. It was a frequent topic of his. And his wife was named Susanna. He called her Susie. They had a relationship for the ages, and it's the perfect picture of how Christ loved the church, but also this idea that in a marriage relationship, we have duties to each other. And understand their life was not perfect, because sometimes people, well, if I had a life like they had a life, right? Their life was not perfect. The first day she met him, she was appalled by his lack of refinement. He was a country boy. They lived in England. He was a country boy, so he had a strange accent, no fashion sense whatsoever. And she was especially appalled by his polka dot handkerchief. This was not love at first sight, is what I'm saying to you. In fact, she later wrote this. Can you imagine your wife writing this about you? She said, "How little I then thought my eyes looked upon him who was to be my life's beloved." She said, "How little I thought of him the moment I saw him." But she wrote this, "It is a mercy that our lives are not left for us to plan, but that our Father chooses for us. Else might we sometimes turn away," and get this, "from our best blessings and put from us the choicest and loveliest gifts of his providence." She's saying, "I am so glad that I did not walk away from you the moment I saw you and was appalled by your lack of refinement. I knew later on that God had a purpose for us." In her 30s, she had an operation that didn't go well, and she was mostly bedridden the rest of her life. So as I read from Scripture and then from their discourse with each other, understand they had a challenging life. They had children, and from her 30s, she was mostly bedridden, and she outlived him, living into the early 1900s. She outlived him, mostly bedridden her entire adult life. But he wrote this about her. Dear purchase of a Savior's blood. That's a beautiful way to refer to your spouse. You are the purchase of my Savior's blood. If your wife, if your husband is the purchase of our Savior's blood, don't you think you would treat them in a certain way if you considered them to be the purchase of the blood of Jesus Christ? And writing to her, he says, dear purchase of a Savior's blood, you are to me a Savior's gift, and my heart is full to overflowing with the thought of such continued goodness. Their life was tough. As a preacher, he traveled a lot. He was reviled constantly in his country, in his homeland, because he was faithful to the Word of God. I do not wonder at his goodness, for it is just like him. But I cannot but lift up my voice of joy at his manifold mercies. Whatever befall us, trouble and adversity, sickness or death, we need not fear a final separation, either from each other or our God. Beautiful picture of a husband and a wife who absolutely adore each other, but in the reality of a difficult life. All relationships have duties and responsibilities. So let's go ahead now. Let's get into 1 Peter with that as the background. Because one of the things that you're going to see, well, it's in the first line and then we'll unpack it. Likewise, wives, be subject to your own husbands, so that even if some do not obey the word, they may be won without a word by the conduct of their wives, when they see your respectful and pure conduct. First thing is, in our culture, we don't like to yield to anyone. All you have to do is drive down I-10, and whenever there's an on-ramp, people don't like to yield to cars going 80 miles an hour. Let them pull over for me. We don't like to submit. We don't like to yield. And right out of the starting gate, we see a be subject to someone, that is, to your husband. But there's a divine purpose for it. Just like the roll at the grocery store to check out the customer, there's a purpose for it. So they can go out and you can get another customer go through. There is a purpose, a divine purpose, and that is this. If your husband is not a believer, they could be won over to the gospel. So just like we saw Paul say, look, I'm going to become weak. I'm going to give up my rights so I can win someone to the good news of Jesus Christ. We see here Peter saying, look, be subject, yield to your husband so they might give their life to Christ if they're not a believer. And so we're getting a little bit of a glimpse into the character of Christ, which is relevant for all of us, whether you're married or not. Even if you never will be married, if you're like, I'm never going to be married, it's okay. We still see the character of Christ in this, and that is, will you yield to Christ and to his commands so that somebody can be won to the gospel of Jesus Christ? And if the answer is no, well, that's pride speaking. If anyone could have been prideful, it would have been Paul, a Pharisee of Pharisees. But yet he said, I will yield to those I meet so they might come to meet Christ in me. And so when we're seeing be subject to your husband, it's not so they have power over you. So they get to experience the Christ in you. And so if they're not a believer, they could be won over. If they are a believer, the tranquility in their home. And isn't that what you want more than anything else, is peace and tranquility? I remember years ago, many, many years ago, when Chris and I were newlyweds, we were in a life group type of a group of young marrieds just like ourselves, and there was a couple in particular. I never forgot this, because whenever the subject of yielding came up, she always would say, very forcefully, I will never yield to my husband. Friend, I can tell you they had the most miserable relationship of anybody in that group. It was terrible. Again, it's like the fireman refusing to go fight the fire. Every relationship has a duty. But we're going to get to the husband's duty. But we're going to continue on first. So do not let your adorning be external, the braiding of hair and the putting on of gold jewelry or the clothing you wear, but let your adorning be the hidden person of the heart with the imperishable beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which in God's sight is very precious. So there you see another little hint into a glimpse into the character of Christ. It's like, don't let your outward appearance overshadow what's inside of you. The most precious thing about you, wife, is the Christ in you. Or for the non-marrieds, the most precious thing about you is the Christ in you. It's not about the superficial stuff. So don't rest on the laurels of the outward, but let the inward shine. And isn't that what Paul did when he said, look, I'm a Pharisee of Pharisees. He sat under the teaching of Gamaliel, which 2,000 years ago, today that name may not ring a bell, but 2,000 years ago, that was somebody. He's like, I'm giving all that up if someone would know Jesus Christ. And in the marriage, the sacred marriage relationship, this covenant between husband and wife, what God is saying, look, yield. Okay? For this is how the holy women who hoped in God used to adorn themselves by submitting. That Greek word means to obey. To their own husbands, as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord. And you are her children if you do good and do not fear anything that is frightening. In a world where weakness or submission is weakness, in the kingdom of God, yielding to the cause of Christ is powerful. Look, when she yields, when the wife in a biblical marriage, a covenant relationship, yields to her husband, it is so powerful that if he's not a believer, he might see the Christ in her and ultimately, by the call of God, give his life to Christ. There's no greater power than that, than to be used by God as a vessel, as an instrument to lead another human being to the Lord, whether it's in a marriage relationship or a friendship or just a stranger. There's no greater power than that. But the world says weak is submission is weakness. But in God's word, to be weak is to have great might. So think of those two words. Let's go back to 1 Corinthians. And I'm unpacking all of this so that by the end of this, when we ask the question again, so what is your view of marriage? You'll say, I have a better view of it. And that relationship between husband and wife is a picture of Christ and the church. So let's go back. So for though I am free from all, I have made myself a servant to all, that I might win more of them. Remember, in the world says to be yielding, submitting is weakness, but in the kingdom of God, to yield, to be weak is great might. So to the weak, I became weak, that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that by all means I might save some. I do it for the sake of the gospel, that I may share with them in its blessings. And friend, as you think about that covenant relationship between husband and wife, I can tell you this. If there is a man who complains about his wife, I guarantee you he is a man who has more than one broken relationship in his life. Because the relationship between husband and wife is the primary relationship that God has called him to Take a look at Ephesians 5. And as you're turning in there, I'm going to read those verses. Charles Spurgeon said this, "When husbands and wives are well yoked, how light their load becomes. Where there is much love, there will be much to love. And when love is scant, faults will be plentiful." As a wife in a biblical marriage yields to her husband, and that husband yields to Christ, what you see is that the affection of the man is centered on the home. You see, all too often in this world, we see husbands' affections. They're on a sports team. They're on activities, whatever. They're on something else. But Charles Spurgeon, he writes this, "A man's home is the place where his affections are centered. Every Christian man will feel, with regard to his own family, that there he centers his affection. He cannot afford to lavish his love everywhere." And man, if you are a married man in this place, you cannot afford to lavish your affection in more than one place. The center of your affection must be your home. That is the center of your affection. He centers it in that particular spot, that oasis in this dark desert. And nothing shall be able to separate us from that love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. "A true husband," he writes, "loves his wife with a hearty love, fervent and intense. It is not mere lip service. Jesus has a delighted love toward his spouse, which is the church." Oh, I see that just like Christ loved the church, a husband is to love his wife. Okay, now we see a little bit more of the character of Christ in the covenant relationship between husband and wife. Can you imagine if Jesus came to earth and said, "The center of my affection is not the church"? He probably wouldn't have gone to the cross for it. He said, "The center of my affection is the Colosseum, the games." Now, the center of his affection was the church. And Spurgeon's saying that also is to be the center of affection of a man of God for his wife. He prizes her affection and delights in her. You wonder at Jesus' love. You admire it. Are you imitating it? In your domestic relationships, is the rule and measure of your love, even as Christ loved the church. Wow, so we read in 1 Peter 3, wives, submit, yield to your husband. In that weakness, you become super strong. You win them over to Christ by his grace, and if they're a believer, you get to experience that peace and tranquility. But husband, let the center of your affection be your wife, be your home. Like Christ loved the church. That is the very center, the burning center of your love is your wife. Charles Spurgeon wrote a love song to his wife. I won't read the whole thing, but he says this because he traveled a lot. He said, "Over the space that parts us, my wife, I'll cast me a bridge of a song. Our hearts shall meet, O joy of my life, on its arch unseen, but strong. Though he who chose us all worlds before must reign in our hearts alone, we fondly believe that we shall adore together one day before the throne." Oh man, that's a beautiful picture of a biblical marriage, husband and wife. In Ephesians then, wives, verse 22 of Ephesians 5, "Wives, submit to your own husband as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and is himself its Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to everything and everything to their husbands. But watch this. Now, usually on the mission field, whenever we do a marriage conference, which would usually be very well attended, right when I got to that part, you see the husbands would kind of sit up like this. Yeah, that's right. Right? I'll say, oh, wait a minute. This is the Paul Harvey rest of the story. You got to read the rest of the verses. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. And that's where the wife would usually needle the husband. It's like, yeah, that's how you're supposed to love me. And so this relationship, as we get to 1 Peter 3, it's like, wife, yes, yield to your husband as Christ yielded to the will of the Father. And husband, love your wife like Christ loved the church as Christ went to the cross for his bride, which is the church. So you too are to treat her as holy because she is the purchase of a Savior's blood. What tremendous responsibility for both husband and wife, but what a glorified relationship. What a beautiful relationship between man and woman, that the wife would submit to him, he would submit to Christ, and both of them would be held together in this divine purpose of glorifying our Savior Jesus Christ. That's marriage according to the Word of God. And husband, one day, as Christ will be held responsible for presenting to the Father a church that is the bride of Christ without blemish, so too are husbands responsible. So too are husbands responsible for leading their wives spiritually. Because one day, God will look at her soul and hold me accountable for how I treated my wife. Oh, all of a sudden, yielding seems like the better part of the deal. But husband, you will be held responsible for the spiritual condition of your wife. And wives, when you yield to your husband, you're not becoming weak. You're becoming so influential in their life. That's why Spurgeon can write that song to his bedridden wife. That's why he could preach so often on marriage, that about the goodness of marriage. Because one day he knew, and they are right now worshiping together. Not as husband and wife, because they're not given to marriage and husband in heaven. But as believers, they are worshiping at the throne together. This is marriage according to the Word of God. So likewise, husbands, live with your wives, verse 7, 1 Peter 3, in an understanding way, showing honor to the woman as the weaker vessel, since they are heirs with you of the grace of life, so that your prayers may not be hindered. Because look, when there's strife, it's hard to be a prayer warrior when your house is full of strife. It's hard to be on fire when your house is boiling over with turmoil. Finally, all of you have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. Do not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, bless, for to this you were called, that you obtain a blessing. For whoever desires to love and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayer, but the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. 1871, 150 plus years ago, Spurgeon wrote this letter to Susie. As we prepare to close, my own dear one, and remember, he traveled a lot, was dedicated to his ministry. He says this, none know how grateful I am to God for you. In all I have ever done for him, you have a large share. For in making me so happy, you have fitted me for service. Not an ounce of power has ever been lost to the good cause of Jesus Christ through you. I have served the Lord far more and never less for your sweet companionship. But yet she was bedridden for most of her adult life. But yet he could say, I have served the Lord far more and never less for your sweet companionship. The Lord God Almighty bless you now and forever. Friend, I can tell you that as a husband and wife, as we yield the husband to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as the husband yields to the cause of Christ and as the wife yields to him in respect, both of them are fitted for a greater service for Jesus Christ. It is not about having some sort of a humility that leads to utter weakness, but it's about seeing the true purpose and the true power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it's about truly becoming one in a covenant of marriage. And even if you're not married and never will be married, do you not see that becoming weak, pouring out the pride of life, you become strong in the gospel of Jesus Christ? And that when we submit to Jesus Christ, some may see the Jesus in us and want that Jesus for themselves. Yielding in the Word of God is not weakness. It's strength. And Charles Spurgeon, the prince of preachers, who by the age of 22 was already preaching to crowds of 10,000 or more, had the audacity to write a letter to his wife, bedridden, but you are the large part of my ministry. And I've never lost an ounce of influence. In fact, I've been far greater in my ministry because of you. Friend, what is your view of marriage? There is a biblical marriage, and it shows the character of Jesus Christ. And when we destroy, degrade biblical marriage, it's not only an insult to God, but it runs counter to the character of Jesus Christ himself. And if you are married, your spouse is the purchase of our Savior's blood. I think God expects us to treat our beloved that way. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, you ask that you would speak to us, Lord. Whether we're married or not, have been married, never will be married, can we not see your character in the covenant relationship between one man and one woman, between a husband and wife? It's a beautiful picture, glimpse into your character, your love for us, your yielding to our Heavenly Father as you went to the cross, not in anger, not resisting, but yielding. And because of your shed blood, we stand here today, saved by that blood. And in marriage, would we love each other, Lord, as the purchase of that blood? That's the call to husband and wife. And to all of us, it's a call to yielding. Submitting to you, becoming weak, so that those weaker yet would come to know Christ. There's strength in that. Bless us as we pray this out to you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Would you all join me in standing? I want to go into our invitation, and if I can pray for you in any way, I'd love to pray with you. I'll be standing here. How's God moving in your heart? Invitation's open. Let's sing this out.
To be.
church. We had such a great time worshiping with you this morning. Before you go, a couple quick things. I'm going to start with a question, actually. Just a show of hands, how many of you miss our church choir? Would you just raise your hand? All right, amen. Well, I got some good news. We are making some steps towards starting our choir up again. If you are interested in joining that, being part of that, feel free to reach out to me. You can do that just today, as well as if you come into the office, reach out to the church office, they can connect you with me. Another thing is we need your help. So we're going to be doing a, next Sunday actually, we'll be taking a poll. We want to find out what kind of music you would like to hear during our Sunday morning services. So we have a couple ways that you can join us in that poll. So we're going to have some physical slips that you can fill out. They'll be in the Heartbeat Bulletins next week, as well as we're going to have it on our app and some QR codes to go to the website if you want to do it digitally. But we want to hear from you. We want to know what you think, what kinds of songs you'd like to hear. With that, we hope that you have a great Sunday. Thanks again for joining us. We hope to see you next week.
I believe in the risen one. I believe I overcome by the power.